Anybody new today, so it's okay. We're glad for the people that are here. We've had a lot of changes today, so let me make sure I get this right. Our reader today is Nancy. Is that still correct? That didn't change, I hope. And we do not have a guest musician. Both of them, one of them had to be out of town, and then Bill Hoffman was supposed to be here. And at midnight, he let me know that he is ill. So our first music person will be a new joy song today, and a reading will be by Nancy. Go ahead. I think it's time for that.
Okay. Hold your horses. I've got on 10,000 hats today. Hold on.
You and me both.
Good thing it's a familiar group.
Yeah, really. There it is. Yay.
Well. Okay. We're flexible right here.
Good morning.
Good morning, Nancy.
Small but appreciative crowd. I think some of y'all should move over here to make it, the ship is sort of listing to the left here. Glad to see every one of you. Today I cultivate a grateful heart by blessing this day and the good that it holds for me and for all. I bless all things and people who touch my life in any way. Recognizing that it is God, the good, expressing in them and through them. David recognized this truth centuries ago when he wrote, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits." I know that as I bless or recognize God's goodness ever present in all is related to my life, I draw forth only the good from within the person or thing that I bless. Francis Wilshire recognized that there is great power in blessing the things of life, and she wrote about this in her book, You. She said, "You see, all good lies dormant in everything, only waiting to be awakened. Blessing not only increases the already tangible good, but brings forth more from the invisible or the intangible. There is no limit to the good blessing can bring into your life. I acknowledge this truth as I go through this day, blessing my home, the things about me, and the people I meet at work, on the street or in the store. I bless each one. I bless everything. I bless this day for the good it holds for me. It is a good day, and it will be a good day all day. I now see the truth of David's decree. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it."
The first hymn today is number 18, Through the Love of God, and we will sing verses 1, 2, and 3.
Mm-hmm.
morning. Nancy, will you put up the first verse?
Ready, wait.
Yeah. Our Bible verse for today is Acts 17:24. God who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands. Let's think about that for a minute. A lot of people will say sometimes when they visit a church, oh, I was there, but I didn't see God there. I just didn't feel God there at all. Well, perhaps they were looking in the wrong place. I'm bold enough to say to you today, Rick, you are the temple of God. I'm bold enough to say, Dale, you're the temple of God. Anne, you are the temple of God. That's a powerful statement. And I'm going to talk to you today about being the temple of God and where you should be looking when you're seeking God. Remember those scriptures that say, seek and you'll find, knock and it shall be opened to you. Just ask and it will be given. Well, let's find out where we're going for those kinds of answers today. And remember, God who made everything dwells within you, not in a temple made with hands. So let's talk today about being the church and what the church is. Amen.
Amen.
Will you join me today for our statement of being? God is all, both invisible and visible, one presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect love and perfect substance. I am the individualized expression of God and am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. That, my friends, is a powerful statement. All right, today we're going to sing a new song, right?
I'm glad it's a small group.
We'll be your guinea pigs.
I'm going to try and lead you in this new joy song. This song has a little history behind it. Doug wrote this song. Our own Doug Watts, thank you. I issued a challenge sometime back, not long ago. The joy song shouldn't be that hard to write. Just find a theme, find a verse, find something you like, and let's put some words to it. So next week, Doug brought me this song. He brought me the words and sang a little bit of it. He said, okay. Something like this, and so if you like it, remember I wrote the music out, and I
you like it.
And I arranged it, and I put it up here for you. And if you don't really care for it, Doug wrote it.
Rick did everything.
Let me sing a line of it, and you sing with me, okay? Now you. Verse one.
God, you gave me open hearts.
joy song?
Yes.
We just did.
Do we have a new songwriter in town?
Yeah.
Anybody just got an idea, bring them, we'll work it out.
We knew we kept you around for a reason, Doug.
Rick.
Rick and Doug, that was lovely.
Thank you.
Well, I'm not wearing a robe today, you know, as part of God's inherencies is wisdom, and I knew I'd be too haunted. So, I am not wearing my robe today, much too hot. And I've been told that I may not fan while wearing the mic, so I just had to dress a little cooler. Let's prepare ourselves now for a time of meditation. As the lights go down, we'll get ourselves settled and ready. Before we go within, we will say a prayer for those in our prayer box, that God, the great physician, will heal, and we count on that. If you'll repeat this name after me, God's blessings be on John. May God's blessings be on JT. And may God's blessings be on all those who you lift up in your heart right now. Knowing that all those on our prayer list are being healed, even as we speak. Now as we take a deep breath together in and out, we release all thoughts that we may have brought with us this morning. And we concentrate intensely and deeply on these statements. I am that spirit which is immortal. I am that peace which is freedom. I am that health which is changeless. I am that wisdom which is perfect. Breathe in with me, please. And out. I am that nature which is always harmony. I am that life, which I know to be eternal. I am that law, which is order. I am that activity, which is equal to all demands. I am that success, which is prosperity. I am that supply which is forever abundant. I am that love which is a conscious unity. Yes, my friends, this is the truth of our divinity. And knowing this truth makes us forever free. God is all there is, both unmanifest and manifest. We are born of God, and His form is spirit substance. His life is the eternal, ceaseless activity of our creative power. We are ever unfolding into the fuller vision of our truth, into deeper realizations of love, which is our true nature. And we are unfolding into full consciousness of perfection, which is our eternal state of being. for a few seconds. Sit comfortable in this truth. Let it be your dominant, strong thought. Open your heart to all that you are, not because of what you've done, but because of who God is. And not because of who you are, but because of what God has first done for us. Sit in the silence and listen. Now, my friends, together, let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed is thy name. Thy kingdom is come, thy will is done on earth as it is in heaven. Thou givest us this day our daily bread. Thou forgivest us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Thou leadest us not into temptation, but dost always deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and all the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Forgive me. It just happens that way. All right. If you don't mind, I'm gonna
stand down there.
Nice, yeah, I'm gonna stand down here and talk to you so I can refer to some notes and move around. I will try to pay attention to my guys on this side as much as I'm paying attention to everybody on this side. If you will for me, I'm going to lift my hand towards you, and if you'll just lift your hand toward me, kind of like what we did when we said a prayer for your wonderful daughter, let's ask that we have our minds open for this prayer. Lord, we are humbly always in your presence. Open our hearts and minds. Dwell in our spirit while we are in the midst of this assembly. Amen. Now, I thought that was important because I want to talk to you about the midst of the assembly. I'm going to start out by giving you a little story about Gabriella, our goddaughter. You know, she was a difficult child. However, I learned a million lessons from being her godmother. There was a time when she was young. I can't quite remember how young, but younger than school age. So probably 4 or 5. And Wanda and I were helping to build a sanctuary, a place where people could come who were feeling unchurched. And what I mean by that is they didn't feel welcome in their own churches for some reason, or the church of their growing up. So we were meeting. We didn't yet have a building. And we were doing church. We were praying together. We were hearing a word from each other. And Gabby, being young, needed to go somewhere and play. But she came to us very solemnly and seriously, and she said, "I want to do church." In her innocence, she knew that we were being the church. And we were not in a building meant for worship, We were not in a place designed specifically for that, but somehow in her innocence and youth and pureness of heart, Gabriella Parker knew that we were being the church and she wanted to be a part of that. I thought that was an amazing life truth that I have held on to all these years. In her innocence, she says, I want to be church. I want to do church. She knew what we were doing. She felt what we were feeling. And I was reminded time and time again that there is a love of spiritual community. And this young child knew so much more that church was not a place, that it was something alive, that it was something living. And like her, I want to be a part of it. Now I know, and I've heard from many of my friends, I have church in my backyard. I have the birds singing, I have the, so I don't need to go to church. Well, I disagree with that. Even though this building, which is quite lovely and comfortable, is not the church, we are the church when we're in community with each other. You know, let me remind you, we are one. We are the church. And while I had the opportunity this morning to call out some people, I'll call out some more. Pam, you are the church. Feel that. Bob, you're the church. I think that's very exciting. Now, ask yourself this question. How can I limit God or confine God to a building? Without raising your hand, because I don't want to know. How many of us feel like, well, if I put in that hour of time, I'm good for the week? Right? Some people do. Or used to. And for some people, it's good enough just to be around people who are at the church. You know, oh, I love her. I'm going to be with around her for a while. She's so gracious. That's good enough for me as long as I'm around someone who's at church. I'm going to make a declaration. I declare that right here in this place, part of the church is gathering. That right here in this very building, new hope is always sprouting. That right here in this place, a lot of us bring our fears and we bring our dreams and we share it with others who are the church. That here in this place, we take communion with each other. And that here in this place, I see new light shining. That we are the body of Christ gathering together in community. And that I celebrate. But I encourage you never to limit God to just a place. The heavens of the heavens of the heavens of the heavens of the heavens cannot contain our God. Right? Can I get an amen on that one?
Amen.
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 Yet, God does dwell in his creation. We are the temples of God. Look, can we look at that verse again? Nancy's being my verse projector.
The first one?
Yeah, all throughout, so you don't even need to close your computer. The first one, I'll read it to you while I'm getting that up. God who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands. I always resist having a title for my talk or my sermon. But if I picked one today, it would be Living Sanctuaries. Now let's look at 1 Corinthians 6:19. It's just the next one. What? I love the way it starts. What? Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from
God,
and that you are not your own? What does that mean, you are not your own?
God bless you.
In some translations, they say even, you are not your own, you were bought with a price. In metaphysical terms, I believe this means, remember, we are one. You're not just you, separate from others. Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, which was given to you. And remember, you're not alone, you're not your own. We are one. And people are always more important than property. Now, we can agree that this church building and us as the church are not defined by the property. I'd like to say again to a few others gathered here, the church is me, the church is you. Sue, you are the church. Cynthia, has anyone ever declared to you, you are the church? Today, I'd like to say, Jane, you are the church. Now, regardless of the style or tradition that we might come to worship together as, I'd like to invite you to think about two ways or two things that really are required when we come together. In John 4:24, it says, God is spirit. So worship in spirit and in truth. So we need to worship in spirit and in truth. We need to engage our emotions and our mind. We need to remember what we know about who we are, and we need to remember or remind each other why we're coming together. When you're not here, I miss you. Because Rick, you're the church to me. And the ministers of this church are the people of this church. Velvet, you minister to me. Did you know that? You are the church. Wanda, you minister to me because you are the church. And if I haven't called your name yet, raise your hand. Nancy.
You talk to me.
Nancy, you are the ministers. You are the church. Grace, when you're not here, I miss you because you're my minister. You are the church. I think that's a declaration you need to hear over and over again. I'm thrilled to be the one to do that today, to be that declarer. Now, I want to give you another phrase to use. It's one I've used for a while, maybe 20 years. I'm sorry to say I'm that old, but for about 20 years, I've used the phrase Jesus' journey. Here in Divine Science, we follow the teachings of Jesus. Am I right? Yes.
It says on the sign.
It says it on the sign, therefore it is true. It's in writing, black and white. Well, I want to invite you to be on a Jesus' journey. I want to say to you, it's not good enough to just come here on Sunday morning. Although, when you're not here, I miss you. Please come. But it's not good enough. If you are the temple of the living God, then what happens when you walk out these doors? Does your Jesus journey only last to about 11:30? That's like we're having a sitcom, right? We come here, laugh at each other in our lives and talk about each other. It's not a sitcom. It's not a 30-minute or one-hour TV show. I want you to live out loud. I want you to live the Jesus journey every single moment. John 10:10, Jesus says, I have come that you might have life. Never did he say, I have come that you might come to church and have religion. He never said that. Said, I have come that you might have life. And you remember what comes after that? That you might have life abundantly, to the fullest. He came to teach us that. And I want to be on that Jesus journey. I want to live out loud. I want my life to be abundant. Not just in forms of money, but in all ways. I'm going to tell you, without quivering, I hope, that I am abundant because of you. I'm abundant because you come and you sit in these chairs and we feel our oneness. And I am abundant because I meet with some of you on Mondays or Wednesdays and we turn our chairs toward each other and we talk and we live the Jesus journey. And never ever has someone I know of been judged by where they are on that journey. For it's an eternal journey. And we're at all different places, right? As we are receiving revelation. No, Jesus never said, meet together on Sunday mornings to have religion. Our spirituality has to be active. Jesus was a life application teacher. In all the stories that I read, he either says, all right, you're forgiven. I've healed you. But he never leaves it there. He says, now go and don't do that sinful thing anymore. If I could sum up the whole of Jesus' ministry, one part of it would be, stop doing that. How's that working for you? Right? If you're feeling guilt, if you're feeling sorrow, if you're feeling pain, stop it. Jesus says, turn within. Remember who you are. Remember your inherences, which are joy, love,
understanding
wisdom. Thank you. And health. And he always wanted those who were gathered around to go and do likewise. He never said, all right, here's your religion dose for today. We're done. He always said, go and do what you've heard. Go and do it. Go and do it as I've done it. My biggest desire for this church, which by the way is not this building, but it is you, my biggest desire for you, is that as a part of the body, we will be living sanctuaries. There's a song that I'm going to play for you a little bit later. And it says, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Pure and holy, tried and true. And with thanksgiving, I will be a living sanctuary for you. Isn't that beautiful? What a great affirmation to start your day with. And I can make you a few promises. Unlike the politicians of today, I believe this to be true and doable. I promise you that when you become in your mind the sanctuary that I'm talking about, you will want to go and do. You won't be able to not go and do. The love will flow, and you will know that the God of all is changing you. And when you are a changed people, I promise you, our worlds will be changed. Our lives will be changed. And we can use a change. Don't you limit God. Don't you do it. And don't limit yourself. Don't you do it. I'm doing things today that I have never known were possible. I'm going to tell you another Gabby story. It's about possibility. And she has no idea that she comes up in my mind all the time when I'm thinking about my life. Wanda, do you remember when we were first taking her to the Y and we were swimming? Well, she wasn't happy about being in the baby pool or the kiddie pool. She wanted a floaty around her and she wanted in the big pool. Well, we were there also with a few friends, and there we are, all like four of us, in the like the 5 foot, you know, I'm Bobby, of course, because I'm shorter than them, and we've all got our arms up, come on, jump in, come on, Gabby, come on. Well, she ticked us off one at a time, you know, like, no, not you, not you, and I'm like, oh, she's going to pick me, she trusts me, and there we are, Wanda and I with our hand, come on. Of course, I'm doing this. Come on.
And she says, in her innocence again, not you. Your arms aren't long enough. I won't Wanda. Her arms are long enough. And there she jumped and, of course, was caught. So I say to you, how long do you think God's arms are? And how often do you say, no, I'm not going to do that because God might not catch me. Don't limit God. Don't limit his arm stretch. I want you to expect change. I want you to expect God to change others because of you. I want you to make that a morning affirmation. Dear God, I am grateful for this new day. I am looking for someone who will be changed because of me, because of who I am in you. Now, I need you to come here, and I'm going to be truthful. There are times when I need you to help me find the strength to forgive when I've tried to do it alone. I need the strength of one. Right? And sometimes I need you to help me find the power of speaking peace into the part of my world where I'm having trouble finding it. And sometimes I need you, the church, to help me repent or change my thinking about who I want to be. And sometimes I need you, the church, to help me reconsider the life of my past and turn around to my present and remember that I am part of a whole people with the indwelling of God. So, my friends, together as a church, let us forgive as we've been forgiven. Let us love as we have been loved, and let us know each other as we have been known by God. Let us be this church that brings a sense of unity for all. And I love this part. It is also becoming one of my affirmations. I want God to show us the way to be diverse without division. We need an amen on that one.
Amen.
And I pray that God will help us be a unified one and know that we are, regardless of uniformity. May God bring us together here in this place as one body. And now to quote a song by a group called Casting Crowns. If we are the body of Christ, then why aren't his arms reaching? Why aren't his hands healing? Why aren't his words teaching? And if we are the body, the church, then why aren't his feet going? Why is not his love showing that there is a way? And I'm going to give you a quiet moment to just think about that. Make it personal. Ask yourself, if I am the body, why am I not reaching, healing, speaking, loving, and going to those who don't know the truth yet? I also want to talk to you about something we need to examine. It's called church growth. Surprise, surprise, it's not about the building or adding to our numbers. Did you expect that? It's not. The church, us, the part of the church, the body of Jesus Christ, the Christ within, all those things, first of all, can grow warmer. That's through fellowship. I love to hug you. Some of us may go a whole week until we meet again without a human person wrapping us in their arms and hugging us. Am I right? There are some of us who can grow just by being warmly loved and hugged. We can also grow deeper through discipleship. And what do I mean by that? By following the teachings of Jesus. And if you don't know them, there's 1,000 books that you can look at. And you can learn every single story. We can grow stronger by being together and broader by ministering to each other. And has nothing to do with growing larger in number. Although that would be nice. I dare say that if we are the church, not just here, but out there, then our community will grow. And it is growing. My friends, we are a mighty instrument in the hand of God when we remember that here in this place we are bound together. Not by any creed and not by any particular doctrine, but by our implicit covenant, a promise to each other to seek together after truth and love. And we value our differences and we honor each person's search for the truth. If you will pray with me right now. Holy God of all, the great I am, thank you for this place. Pour your blessing and your strength into this part of the body, this part of your church, which we present to you as an offering of our service. Purify us and create within this place vibrations of tender and spiritual truth. We dedicate ourselves this day as temples of the Holy Spirit. God, help us to cooperate in effort and in harmony for the uplifting of all who search. Let your divine spirit dwell not only in this place, but our souls, so that all who come within these doors here at Valley Community may recognize that this is your house. And that these people are your church, and that we all go forth blessed and ready to pass that blessing on to others. Dear God, let it be so. And we all say, Amen.
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 Now we will have a musical interlude
via recording.
It's coming.
I know.
I am you.
hope I'm doing things in the right order here. It's time blessing for the blessing of the gifts. If you don't know it, it's in the order of your order of service.
Yep.
Today,
I acknowledge God, omnipresent, as the source of all good, as the source of my good. With this acknowledgement, I accept His will, which is abundance in every aspect of my life. I release all thoughts of lack and limitation, and I am open and receptive to the increased flow of abundance to me right now. I joyfully accept the gift of life, and give freely of the special gift that I am. Through me, God omnipresent blesses and multiplies this gift for all. Thank you, dear God.
So I take two or three. And he really puts them, where'd you say, like on your mirror? And so he sees that name and prays for that person. And, you know, I get sometimes the name of someone I don't know, and then sometimes the name of people I do know. And I pray just the same, right? And I know that we're all blessed by our prayers. So we'll start over here. But don't forget to get over there to Jerry, because he's going to take two or three. Thank you, my friend.
Okay, do some short announcements here. The Monday night, tomorrow night will be the last Monday night class until September the
12th.
We're going to take a month's vacation. Are you paying for a vacation?
Yeah, where we going?
Yeah, we're going to watch a short video and we'll have a short discussion. But also tomorrow night, we'll go. Everybody bring a snack. We're going to. Kind of celebrate tomorrow night. Wednesday night we still have the coffee, meet at the coffee house, and we have lots of fun there. It's always very enjoyable. And if you want to laugh and talk about whatever, then come on out to Wednesday night if you're not doing anything.
And we do laugh and talk about whatever.
That's exactly right. We do.
It's a great time.
A reminder, there will be no Wednesday night class this week. Marita is out of town, so we will not have a Old Testament class.
Well, we did decide.
Are we still having?
We decided that last week we listened to Eric Butterworth, an amazing man. He talked on, we had him on a tape, and we had great discussion. I think you'll agree, Doug, Mom, and all those that were there. It was a fabulous class. So Marita gave us permission in her absence that we could meet and listen to the second part of that.
Okay.
Or another part of that. We think it's the second part.
Well, we hadn't flipped it over yet.
So, because it's an old-fashioned tape. But you don't have to have been at that one. And I'm going to say, because it's kind of off our course, since Marie's on her vacation, anyone can come, even if you're not going to be studying. Okay. Everyone will be invited to listen. It was a great, when I got home, I said, gosh, Juana, that was one of the best classes I've been to. Mm-hmm. On Wednesday night, and we had great discussion, and Eric Butterworth is an amazing teacher of New Thought. So please come on out, but we won't be doing the Old Testament class.
Okay.
That we usually do with Marita. Okay. Since she's on vacay and going to the conference.
It's still at 5?
Still at 5.
Okay. All right, yeah, thanks for letting me know that, because I didn't have that down here.
Well, we just kind of decided.
Bob, we're still going.
Yeah, Butterworth, as most people know, he's one of my favorite New Thought. I just love him. And so if you can come out with that, that would be great. For the ones that came out yesterday to the kayaking, we had a great time. So I encourage everybody to come to some of these events that we have. It's always fun. You get to know each other, and as Melanie said, it's church away from church, but we just always have a great time and always plenty to eat, and so you get to learn a few things about people that you didn't know that you don't find out there at church. So our next event will be it's 2 weeks from yesterday. We're going tubing again on the New River. We don't know the time yet, but Kate will have to know next Sunday if you're going, because she has to make reservations. So we had a great time last year, so hopefully that more people can go this year. So please try to consider going on that tubing trip. It's just great. So anyhow, let us know by next Sunday. Also, we're collecting peanut butter, and I meant to make a one call on that. I'll do it this week. We're collecting peanut butter for Feeding America. Next Sunday will be the last Sunday that we'll collect, and then I'll take it over to their office. Please try to go to the store, or when you go, pick up an extra jar of peanut butter or something.
Crunchy or smooth?
Doesn't matter. They don't care. As long as they get it. Also, as I made an announcement last week, today the Voices of Faith are having an open house. They're doing this as a community thing. This Sunday, it's at Our Lady of Nazareth Church from 2 to 4. So anybody that can go, just if you go for a few minutes to represent our church, would be great. We're going to have an open house here. We haven't decided when, but we're going to be joining that group so that it's nice to know what other churches do and get involved in the community. So if anybody can go by there, that's today, yes.
Today
from 2 to 4. So if you can just go for a few minutes, that would be great. So we'd appreciate that. Ann Deer made a card for Emily because she's going to be going, as most of you know, to Japan. So if you'd like to sign that card so we can give it to her, that would be great. So
it's a beautiful card.
It is a beautiful card. Ann does a wonderful job.
Yeah.
And we're glad to see you here today, Ann. So thank you for making that card. So if you haven't signed the card already, please do so, and then we'll give it to, when is she leaving again?
August
17th. All right, and today's flowers are for Martha's birthday, and she's not here, but we'll see that she gets them tomorrow or the next day or whatever. So, okay? All right, I think that's all the announcements. Anybody else have an announcement they want to make? Are you going to make something else?
Yeah, for benediction.
Okay. All right, our final hymn is going to be number 64, Flow, Spirit, Flow, in verses 1 and 2. Exactly.
Last time.
Yeah, three.
song that I told you about. I thought would be a good, I call it a heart song, a song for you to start each day with. Thank you, Rick. Anyway, sing along a couple of the portions. It's a great benediction.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a
God's blessings be on you always. Amen.